Hi, it's Rob Tour. You're watching Into Him with Real Estate. We're talking about how to take your money, RSPs, and invest it in real estate developments. 905-595-5483 is the number to call. Mark Vasilius is our guest tonight. Thanks for coming on the show.
Rob, any time for you, my man.
We're halfway done. Time is flying
by. It's a hot night tonight. I got to tell you right now. I'm burning
you're
up.
You're hot.
Yeah, yeah.
So let's go to the phone and answer some questions. We've got John on the line. Hello, sir.
Hi, how are you?
Good, how are you?
Oh, good. I got a question. I got money in RSPs.
Yep.
And I'm thinking of switching it over. But if I switch it to a trust company, how do the trust companies make their revenue?
How does the trust money make money? Actually, it's funny. We were just talking about that on the break. And we were asking, so there's got to be some fees involved. What are they? A few hundred dollars?
That's exactly right. So that's probably why one of the reasons why, John, that some of the banks got out of it is that the banks were not making money on it.
Right.
So how they make money is this, there's a setup fee, I think, of about $125 and then yearly of about $50 or $100. So your total fee over two years would be $250. And depending on the project, I'm pretty sure that gets covered by pro funds. So there's actually no fees at all.
So there's no fees at all.
And let me just be clear on that, is that that depends on the project. And depending on how the project is set up, but just to be clear, it can be up to $250.
And of course, you know, we're talking about RSPs, but this is not a real estate investment trust. So John is only investing in a specific project. He knows all the due diligence has been done before we offer it, and so he's looking at this whole thing. He looks at if there's any fees, what are the fees, what are the timelines, when is he getting paid, worst case scenarios, all that kind of stuff.
The key difference that I started figuring out is the word called fund. This is not a fund. This is these are opportunity driven. These are site specific investments that you, being self-directed with your RSP, would make, and you put it on this project because you like the sound of it. It's a project right around the corner. It's a project that you know. It's in a city that you know. You invest it. You get your return. And you get your money back. This is not a fund where you pooled money is pooled, and then it's up to some advisor that you pay a certain percentage to manage
whether
your money.
Whether you make money or not.
There's no managing of money here. It's straight. The money is being used for something that you can touch.
Nice. Is there a lead off for that, John, or does that suffice?
Perfect. Thank you very much.
Okay. You're very welcome. Thanks for watching. We've got another caller. We've got Chris on the line. Hello, sir.
Hi. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Pretty good. I have a related question. It's not exactly the same, but self-directing my RSP to my own mortgage. Let's say I have a $150,000 mortgage now, say 3.5%.
Yep.
And I have, say, $200,000 or $250,000 in RSP money.
Yep.
I've heard of it. I want to know what you think of and any tax implications of paying my mortgage off with my RSP, and then I would be paying myself or paying my RSP. I guess is what I would be doing.
Sure. So, you know, I actually tried to do this, especially when I was, investing just in properties. And unfortunately, which Mark will explain here, arm's length transaction.
That's the word.
Right?
Yeah.
It needs to be an arm's length. It can't be to my own property. I don't even think it can be a physical family.
Well, yeah. And Chris, I hate to be the bearer of bad news. It sounds like you already own a home. If this is your very first purchase, you're allowed, I think it's $25,000 of your own money for an RSP if it's your first home. If you've already got a home and you're thinking, wow, I'm liking what Mark's saying, I think I'd like to use my RSP, you can't. Arm's length means you don't own it, you don't have a piece of the pie, even for investors.
I think I found a trust company that said I could do non-arm's length. I couldn't. It had to be only a certain amount of my total RSP, if I wanted to put 150 in, I might have had to have 250 available.
I've been doing it 25 years. Mark's been doing it for how long?
15 now.
15 years. I've never heard of it. But listen, promise me that you'll email me if that is true, because
I'm pretty positive.
Okay.
I found a couple trust companies in Toronto that would do it, but there was definitely, if you had $200,000 in an RSP and $200,000 mortgage, no, you couldn't do that. They would do about, I'm thinking 50-60%. I guess that would, because it was non-arm's length, maybe they considered it riskier.
Never heard of it, but like I said, please email me or Mark if you do find out. I mean, you don't have to mention the trust companies, you know, right now, but if you can email me them, I'd love to check it out and I could get a definite answer for you.
Sure. Okay.
Thanks for calling, Chris. Thanks for watching.
Thanks, Chris.
Okay. I mean, I actually went as far as saying, let me take, because it was one time I did it. One time I threw, I think, 70 grand into RSPs. When it turned into 40, I took it out, got taxed on it, and made it all back in real estate investing. Yeah, imagine that. But I wanted to take it, and I wanted it to direct it to a friend. And then I wanted him to direct it to my house. You know, I was trying to do, but there's just nothing you can do. There's just, who makes that rule that it must be arm's length?
That's the tax implications. That's the whole structure of how why an RSP is what it is.
Okay.
They, in a roundabout way, they want to protect you from yourself.
Yeah.
In other words, they don't, like, as much as they want self-directed RSPs, they want to make sure that you're not like the government doesn't want to be paying all your retirement. They want you to be self-forced into self-saving. They don't want you to make a mistake. So they're kind of like creating rules and limiting your ability to invest in. I think I'm just going to invest it in gold stocks, or I'm going to invest it in wherever. No, they've created these rules right from the very beginning.
Okay, so we talked about RSPs. Can we also use in a TFSA account? Can I use a Lira?
Any registered and including cash as well. That anything that's registered as a retirement, whether it's a Lira, TFSA, anything that has the tax deferral program in it, can be used in this program.
And this is not the governing body of mortgages. Is not the Ontario Securities Commission, but it's FISCO, which you've mentioned a couple times. FISCO
Council of Ontario.
Okay, so this is under FISCO. FISCO obviously has some rules, so therefore Pro Funds, which obviously has to, align themselves with the guidelines that FISCO mandates.
And just to be clear, you know, you have mortgage brokers, and then they can then go up to 22 people on a mortgage, and that's called a syndicate.
Oh, is that right?
Yes, they can.
Okay, so a maximum of 22.
But here's the big difference, Rav, is then there's a whole special administration license that you have to get with FISCO, have money sitting in a letter of credit, all kinds of extra rules, all kinds of things.
Which you have.
Which we have, which Valor has, ProFunds has.
Yeah.
And we can now, thousands of investors, so we can go up to hundreds of millions.
Oh, I see.
So that there's a specific administration license, as you'd call it, to go past.
But for this, for example, for this deal in Barrie, where you only had six investors,
we didn't even have to use that.
Okay. Yeah. So what's the minimum? So somebody's watching, they've got either cash, RSPs, Lira, TFSA, they've got some money. What's the minimum that we need to get involved?
Well, you know, again, that's probably...
Is there a minimum?
There usually is. I wouldn't want to go below 10,000, and I'm going to say this in all honesty. It's project driven. It's opportunity driven, as I was saying. It's not necessarily a fund and here's the minimum. If the project demands it, we may go down to 10, but most times it's about 25,000, because then the fees ends up being 0.1% of the total project.
So $25,000. Okay.
Yeah, 25, yeah.
And how many of these projects does someone like ProFunds, Valor Capital, do in a year?
Right now, we've got about six. We're going to probably do eight this year.
Okay, so eight.
Yeah, yeah.
And obviously, you're not picking every deal you see
every
builder brings to you. You have to, again, do your due diligence.
We look at probably about 20 deals a month, and out of which we may select one. And Rav, that is why it's a very lengthy process. I was involved with development. My partner was involved with managing, project managing. So with the two of us, we spend most of our time, as I said, structuring the actual deal. And then we say, once it's financially, you know, sound, or once we believe this project will be sound, then we take it. And then it's got to go through the whole underwriting process, all the due diligence behind, all the loan to values, all that gets determined. So there's a multi-stage process before a project is even accepted.
And what about the reporting? So, I guess I'm going to see the money if it's quarterly, if it's monthly, I'm going to see it come in my bank. So there really doesn't need to be much reporting because the money's there. So obviously things are going well.
Yeah, I mean, you're going to be getting, the nice thing about this structure is that it's laid out. You're going to get your payments laid out very clearly every month, every quarterly. Most times it's every month, depending on the size of the project, and you get your 8% every month, just like clockwork.
Okay. Folks, this is a call-in show. 905-595-5483 is the number to call. We're talking to Mark Vasilius, and we're talking about how you can take your RSP money, or really any money, and act as the bank towards the builder's mortgage, if you will. What about, I mean, there's a lot of the, you know, it's interesting. Those that don't have a lot of money or those that just, you know, are mitigate risk, want to, you know, want to be able to sleep really at night. Yeah. They take the money that they have and they invest it. But then there's a lot of savvy kind of the more affluent, you know, the $1 million players that actually refinance their entire home. And they say to themselves on a deal like this, hey, if I can make 12, 13, 14% and refinance my home and pay, you know, maybe 4 or 5%, I'm clearing 9 or 10% and it's not even my own money.
At the beginning of the show, Rav, I was saying, you know, the supply and demand thing, that right now we're in a very low interest rate environment.
Yes.
And that's why RSPs are so low. Well, that's also a reason why you can get prime plus one and you're paying 3% on your own money. So when you talk about refinancing your home, you can use banks' money now because they're strapped. They're limited to what the Bank of Canada dictates at 3%. And we're saying, hey, here's a project 12, 14%. Well, now you're making 10, 11% on someone else's money.
Sure.
And I think that is something.
So a lot of people doing that?
Oh, absolutely. Because why have you know, I believe in what they call the good debt, bad debt structure. Well, you're putting debt. There's no doubt you're putting debt, but that debt is making you money. You're not buying a TV here. You're not buying a car.
Yeah.
You're not buying something that devalues.
Yeah.
You're investing in something that's going to go up.
I'm borrowing money from the bank at 4%, and I'm making 14% lending out. It's actually what the banks do.
That's exactly.
They take our money.
Yep.
They spit us out, you know, 1%, 2%, and they go make more money, and they're happy with their, you know, their small points.
Next Thursday on May 30th, we're going to go through that process and explain exactly that, saying, hey, you are the bank. And that's what a self-directed RSP can become. And I think that people need to become educated on that part and say, hey, you know what? I'm in charge of my retirement. I got to do something about this, and I'm not going to let the banks run my life. And I know it may not be it for everybody, Rav, but slowly people are waking up and realizing, you know what? Canada's housing market has not seen the meltdown. We don't have those weird mortgages we had in the U.S. We're pretty stable.
So, you know, obviously if it's RSP money, it's got to be self-directed. But if it's my own cash, what do you think about, like, you know, once I come to this meeting on the 30th, I listen to the accountant and see what he has to say. Suppose I want to incorporate. So can I have for a few $100, incorporate a numbered company, you know, 1234567 Ontario Inc., put some money in it, then from that incorporation, give it to you guys. And so that any of the returns I make goes back into my because if not, if it's just cash, I'm assuming it's now considered income and it gets attached to my normal monies.
You're asking a borderline
tax question,
a tax question, but a legal question as well.
Okay.
So you want to say you want to incorporate? When I was doing the rental property thing, a lot of people talk about incorporating and, you know, having the umbrella corporation own all these properties. There's also a different tax structure to a corporation, which can be good, but a corporation doesn't really make sense until you start punching north of $400,000 or $500,000 of income.
Okay.
So when you start saying, you know, setting up a corporation, well, now every year you're going to have a separate tax return. That's going to be $1,000. The cost to set it up is $500. So unless you're, and I like yourself, Rav, I know you're multi-millionaire, so setting up a corporation would be good. But for an average guy, it says, you know what, I've got maybe $100,000 of equity. I got a credit line already set up. I can use $100,000. There's no need to set up a corporation. That's an extra cost and an extra thing. Keep it under your name. Keep it simple is the way I like to do it. So the corporation
makes sense. So if I'm giving you $100,000, I'm making, you know, $12,000, $13,000, $14,000 a year.
Yep.
It's not worth it to
set up a corporation.
Might as well just put it to the income.
Okay. And I would advise you to go talk to your lawyer.
Yeah.
Go talk to an accountant. Come to the seminar. We're gonna have lawyers and accountants there, and they're gonna explain how to really do it. And they're probably, hopefully, they'll say the same thing. You know, you got to start getting some higher numbers in that.
Okay. I don't know how many when I was active, I maybe sold 250, 300 homes, buying, selling, investing for people. I like to take people from A to Z. I like to, you know, really make sure that they're protected. But at the end of the day, I always had to make sure so I could sleep at night. It's your decision. So if I'm helping Mark get his portfolio going, it's your decision. Buyer beware. You have to take full responsibility. This is an investment. And in the same way, you know, as handsome as you are, as a great intellect you have, and you've been doing it, people have got to be able to do their own due diligence. Let me ask you this question. In the 10, 15 years you've been doing this and you've been helping people, have we lost a dollar?
No.
We've never lost a dollar.
Never lost a dollar, no.
If you did, you know where I was going. If you did, it's okay because these are real estate investments. I mean, one in how many ever projects. But you're saying in the last 10, 15 years of helping people to invest in real estate in their RSPs, you've never lost a
never
dollar.
Never lost? Not. I got nothing to hide here. I mean, some projects didn't make as much as we thought, but everybody made money.
That's amazing. Listen, they made more than what they were making with the bank
and RSPs. And I got to be the more that happens, and as I can say, the closest that I came, that's why I believe in real estate. I said, you know, real estate is the values and how real estate itself is working in Canada. You're safe. You know, it's a bricks and mortar, right? Yeah. It's that whole thing. You're not buying a piece of paper that says that you own a stock. Yeah. You're buying something that you can touch and taste. Yeah.
And cash flow. Yeah. I mean, you know what? I like real estate developments. I'm not necessarily so much anymore interested in the cash flow. I like to increase my capital. But there's a lot of people, yourself included, that like that money coming in monthly. And this is a perfect, you know, if I had RSPs, this is where I would put my money. My mom has RSPs. I put her money as a mortgage, as the bank, to somebody's home.
Yep.
It was an individual. So, yeah, actually, why don't we talk about that for a second?
Sure.
So what we're talking about tonight is syndicate mortgages, where we're pooling our money together. We're
for much larger projects.
For big larger products, better returns, obviously.
That's right.
But there's also the individual ones that sometimes you come across where, you know, somebody has a $500,000 house, the value of it, they've got $250,000 of equity, and they need $50,000 for whatever. They don't want to go to the bank. They don't want to refinance because they don't want to get a different rate. They love their rate. Somebody could self-direct their monies that way as well. They could give somebody...
You're not talking about an RSP then. You're just simply saying they got a line of credit on their home?
Line of credit on their home, yeah.
Yeah. They can take, and of course, yeah.
I'm saying even if they had an RSP. If I had an RSP and Mark needed $50,000,
right.
Could I not be the bank for you as a second mortgage?
I mean on a regular home kind of thing?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Sorry, and that's a big part of what ProFunds does. And that's why when I say that they've done $1 billion, most of Carmen at ProFunds, she's done a lot of that kind of business.
Yeah, and Valor Capital came along and said, hey, and let me help you get into bigger and better deals.
That's exactly right. She was doing, she just because, you know, her experience was really in the second mortgages where she was placing RSP money into a $500,000 home, into apartment buildings, into investor. She just loves that world. We came in and said, hey, wait a second. Let's look at the development world and start looking at the larger syndicates. And that's why Valor is connected to the hip on that.
And that's kind of what Chris was talking about. I mean, although he wants to do it to his own, what he was saying is, can I take my money in a sense and put it to one house and be the bank? And he can do it as long as it's arm's length.
That's great.
I've never seen it doing it to your own house, but
it'd be nice. But
you know, so talk to me a little bit about the due diligence. So all of a sudden, there's builders out there; they're catching wind, obviously, of Valor Capital, ProFunds. Well, ProFunds has been around for
20 years.
20 years. So they already know about them. A builder comes across a piece of an opportunity, puts the money down on the land, needs some money. All of a sudden, calls ProFunds.
You bet.
What happens?
Well,
talk to me about the due diligence.
Well, in my world, everyone, including every real estate agent in the world, says, "Oh, you know, when you're looking at a piece of land, it's site plan ready, or it's real close to being draft plan approved," and all these fancy schmancy words, which simply mean that I understand you think that it's close to being built. I need to verify that. And Rav, I'm telling you, that can be anything from, "Well, I called the city, and the guy says, yeah, no problem, we'll approve it," to, "Yeah. Here's the engineering doc." So to go from there to there, everyone's interpretation of what draft planning and site planning means is a whole world. That really is a lot of the dealings we do. Because when you're dealing with a development project, you're doing what I call change of use. You're taking a piece of something that's worth, let's say, $100,000, and you're now going to change its use from a raw piece of land to an industrial complex, to a residential property, totally different tax facility, everything. That process is where the due diligence in what we mostly do is done. Because if a builder is going to come to us, he's going to need help and financing and either getting paid back or moving the project to where, okay, now we can go for sales.
Yeah.
Once sales start happening, then banks start and everyone starts going, whoa, I feel better now. So there's a real question mark period.
So even though we're going to pay a premium for that land because now it's site ready, it's still worth it, and that's where we're making the returns. Because, listen, I'll tell you something. What I know is the municipality, the government, they love to take their time.
You bet.
So just because we've got this piece of land and they say, oh, yeah, you know, within a few months, you're going to be able to put basement apartments in Brampton. Yeah, that's what they say is going to happen this fall. It could happen 5 years from now.
Absolutely right.
And it just takes one person to put up a stink, and all of a sudden we have to now honor and go through the due diligence of that.
That's exactly right. And that's where, when I say what Valor does for the ProFunds connection is...
Yes.
Is you got
to
call?
No, hold that thought. We're going to go to break, and I want to hear that when we come back.
All right.
You've been watching Intune with Real Estate, the hottest show in the world. Don't go anywhere. Mark's closing thoughts in just a moment. Thanks for watching.